colleagues, students, guests, ladies and gentlemen, I am very happy to introduce our today's guests, well, yesterday's and today's, Professor Dieter Wolf, who is Foundation Professor of European Studies at the Department of Government, Harvard University, well known and one of the most famous authors, scholars in the field of political economy of capitalism, institutions, European political economy, especially institutionalism and successful societies topics. So those of you who are interested in these topics definitely know Peter and his writings. They are a very common reference. So we do have here a world famous scholar. I think it's very fair to say without exaggeration. And for this, I first of all, of course, want to thank again Peter for taking time to fly from Boston to Vilnius. I want to express my gratitude to Rector of Vilnius University, Artūras Žukauskas, and his team for providing financial assistance to make Peter's lectures here possible. And I want to thank my colleagues, Vytautas Kuokštis, who presented in person our invitation to Peter to come to Vilnius, also Agli and Vilnius and others who dealt with all the logistics that is always an important and necessary part of any such event. So I'm very glad that Peter will discuss what is on the minds of many people today, but of course he will approach this from his own scholarly perspective. Just as a short introduction, I would say that what we read, what we hear about presidential elections in the US, about Brexit, about elections in Europe this year, and debates about populism could probably be categorized as three types of cleavages. One type is us demos, voters against elites, against so-called systemic parties, against technocrats, lawyers in the constitutional courts, technocrats in the European Union, European Commission, about the distance between voters and elites in a broad sense, both political and technocratic in international organizations and national politics. So the cleavage that could be described as political alienation as one explanation of the so-called new populism. The second cleavage is us common people, working class in some cases, versus business elites, or as they say in the US, Main Street versus Wall Street. Again, what can be called economic alienation by some scholars. And this is also often referred to when people explain the rise of new populism. And the third cleavage, I would say, is among us nation or ethnic groups in the US, white Anglo-Saxon Protestant Americans and others, either immigrants or other ethnic groups, what can also be called identity politics. And we can read that a lot of authors, when they provide the explanations of the election of Donald Trump or Brexit or popularity of Marine Le Pen, they refer to identity politics. So I would say there are at least three broad general accounts of this phenomena that Peter is going to talk about. I don't know what his account will be, maybe a combination of these three, maybe something completely different. So I'm very interested to hear that. If you are not convinced, that's very good, because we have time for questions and discussion after his talk. If you don't agree again, please don't hesitate to argue, to ask questions. We agreed that Peter will talk for 45 minutes approximately, and then we will have about half an hour for Q&A session. So please welcome Professor Peter Goh, and I'm sure we will have a very interesting lecture.
Gracious introduction, and I too want to thank Vitotis and Aglaé for all the work they did to make it possible for me to be here. I've never been to Vilnius before, and it's really a wonderful experience. I'm very grateful to have the opportunity to speak to you. I'm just going to get some water so that I lose my voice. I will find it back, perhaps. So, although this may seem a jarring observation to make on a beautiful day in downtown Vilnius, I think we live in a very strange political world. It's a world in which an impetuous president of the United States can say in one day that NATO is obsolete and in another day that it's very important. It's a world in which a British prime minister can say that if you are a citizen, if you believe you are a citizen of the world, you are a citizen of nowhere, which makes me a citizen of nowhere, and a world in which the leader of the governing party in Poland can describe immigrants as carriers of parasites and quota, so on. In short, we live in a world in which populist candidates, as everyone here knows, have secured a strong foothold in the electoral politics of many countries, and sometimes enough votes to win elections that are highly consequential. Elections that take Britain out of the European Union or put highly unpredictable presidents into office in countries such as the Philippines, Turkey, and the United States. So populism has been around for many years. Think of Juan Perón. Here he is in Argentina with his beautiful wife, Evita, the subject of a rock musical. I don't know whether Marine Le Pen will ever be the subject of a rock musical or not. But populism used to be a Latin American sport. Today, it's a phenomenon with worldwide reach. And even if many Europeans are breathing a sigh of relief in the wake of the elections in Austria, the Netherlands, and France, where populist candidates didn't do as well as many expected. Populism remains a significant political force, I think, across the Western democracies and beyond, commanding essentially a solid base of about 25% of the electorate in most of these countries. So, I use the term populism in a classic sense to refer to politicians who run against a political establishment which they present as corrupt or incompetent, claiming to speak on behalf of a unified people who are seen as pure or virtuous. And of course, populism comes in both right-wing and left-wing variants, although I'm going to concentrate my own remarks today on populism of the political right. And I'll talk mainly about Western Europe and the United States. I know a little bit about East Central Europe, but I'm hoping that I'll learn more in the discussion. We know that the alignments of politics in the East and West of Europe are somewhat different, and so bear in mind that I'm thinking particularly of Western Europe, which I study and know something about. I want to consider three questions. First of all, who are the principal supporters of populist causes and candidates in Western democracies? Secondly, and this will be the core of my remarks, how might we explain the recent rise in support for populism and populist causes and candidates? And then thirdly, I'll say something, and we can talk more in the discussion period, about what are the implications of populism for democratic politics. So let me start with the beginning. Who are the principal supporters of populist candidates? And first thing that must be said is that where populist candidates, whether they be Donald Trump or the supporters of Brexit, where they win elections, they do so on the back of a very broad coalition, which brings together social groups of diverse kinds, a diverse set of constituencies. So it's important to note that in the last American presidential elections, for instance, 90% of Republican voters voted for Donald Trump. Many of them disliked him to some degree. They weren't supportive of all his policies, but they disliked his opponent, Hillary Clinton, more than they disliked him. And many of them in particular wanted to ensure that it was a Republican president who appointed justices to the Supreme Court. That's an effect that can last 20 to 30 years and of enormous importance. So that where populist causes win, it's on the basis of a broad coalition. And note as well that in every country where populists do well, there's something nationally distinctive about their appeal, something nationally singular about why they win there. If Tolstoy were alive today, he would probably say that all nations are unhappy, but every nation is unhappy in its own way, and I think that's true in this case. But having said that, there's a core constituency for right-wing populism that is strikingly similar across the Western democracies, and here I'm drawing on a variety of studies, including some of my own. First is, I think we all know, this constituency is predominantly a working class constituency. If the radical right parties that appeared in the 1950s and 1960s, think of the Poujadiste party in France, for instance, these were parties predominantly of shopkeepers, small employers. They were anti-tax parties in many cases, think of the Danish case. Well, today the constituency for these parties is different. It lies in routine manual workers, clerical employees, people in low-wage service sector jobs, and to some extent also people in the countryside. So you can see in these figures from exit polls for Brexit on the one hand and the first round of the French presidential election, it's clear that the core of support for right populist parties lies in a native working class. And this, of course, is one reason why these parties pose such a challenge to social democracy in Western Europe in particular. It's not clear that social democracy is going to survive this particular challenge. And although I won't say much about this, by contrast, if we look across the OECD countries, support for left populist parties on the other side of the political spectrum is drawn from very different constituencies. The group that expresses strongest support for left populist parties are actually socioeconomic professionals. And if you wonder who they are, they're the people in this room. So there are really very different constituencies for left populism and right populism. And of course, as everyone here knows, there's regional variation. We find much more support for left populism in Southern Europe than in the North. So that's my first point about the sources of support. Secondly, as I think you probably know, the single best predictor of support for right populism is level of education. So in Britain, for instance, 78% of people with a college education, in other words, 78% of people with a college degree oppose Brexit, while two-thirds, 65% of people without a college education supported Brexit. So education is a critical dividing point. Third, support for right-wing populism tends to be higher among men than women, and it tends to be higher among older people than younger people. And once again, you can see this very clearly here in the exit polls for the American election over on the right-hand side. But this is not universal. So young people were just as likely to support Marine Le Pen as older people. And support for Brexit, leaving the European Union in Britain, was roughly equal among men and women. And then finally, and I think quite importantly, for those of us who study politics, support for right and left populism is highly regionalized. That is to say, it varies dramatically across parts of the country, any country in particular. And across Europe, notably in general, support for left populism is strongest in the cities, in large cities, while support for right populism is much stronger in smaller cities and the countryside. And that is true across countries, not just in an individual country. And as you can see from these maps, support is broadly regionalized. Marine Le Pen, for instance, drew support from the deindustrializing segments of France in the northeast, and as she has for some time along the southern rim, along the Mediterranean. And you can see the, I think you can see these slides. You can see the case for Brexit and its spatial variation as well. And this is the point I'm going to return to. Let me turn to my second question, and I think the most difficult question. How might we explain the rise in support for populism in recent years, particularly right-wing populism? And as many of you will know, there's active debate about this. I just picked a few headlines off the blogosphere. And much of this debate is monomaniacal. That is to say, many commentators are trying to identify the one single important cause behind the populist phenomenon. Some think it's cultural, some psychological, some economic, as if this were a phenomenon with a single cause. And I'm going to argue against that view. I think it's multi-causal. But before explaining why, let me identify three types of factors, each of which I think plays a significant role in the rise of populism over the last 10 to 15 years. So I want to suggest that populism, right populism in particular, has its roots in a cultural revolt, first of all, secondly, an economic revolt, and thirdly, a political revolt. I want to say a little bit about each of those. Let me start with the cultural revolt. I think, as everyone here well knows, in Western Europe and in many other developed democracies in the past three decades, we've seen what can only be described as a cultural transformation. You know, social scientists sometimes think that a culture is an inertial variable, that economics changes, politics changes, but culture moves very slowly. Well, in point of fact, that's not the case. Culture moves very quickly, and in many instances, and it moves quickly because of generational change. So it's the people in this room who are shifting the culture of Europe, and in many cases shifting it relatively quickly. And the same thing is true in the United States. So we see in the last 20 years growing public support in Western Europe in particular for what are sometimes termed post-materialist values. So these are values associated with gender equality, racial equality, growing tolerance for abortion, gay marriage, heterodox lifestyles. And you can see that in these basic figures. Of course, this varies across countries and across places. This is a famous figure from Ronald Engelhardt, who first drew our attention to this. And post-materialist values are those as you move right on the x-axis there on the bottom spectrum. So the most post-materialist countries are over on the right-hand side, and the y-axis, the vertical axis, is simply a measure of religiosity. More religious countries are at the bottom, more secular at the top. It won't surprise you, many of you will have seen this before, it won't surprise you that the countries of Eastern Europe, and we're in one of them, tend to be more secular, or Lithuania may be a bit of an exception in the current period. This is, these figures are from 1997, by the way, so they're you know, at least they're 20 years old, so that's maybe an issue here. The U.S. turns out to be relatively religious. It's down, I can't find it, I can't see it from here, but it's down around here. But it's the countries of Northern Europe, and of course always the Nordic countries are the most post-materialist and the most secular. So there's a national variation. And some scholars have argued that right-wing populism in particular is primarily a reaction against this cultural transformation, notably on the part of older men who no longer recognize or feel comfortable in the midst of this new world. So I'm an older man, I feel relatively comfortable so far, at least we haven't got to the discussion. But I'm sure that many of you know others who are not feeling so comfortable. In the memorable words of the anthropologist Margaret Mead, the world is changing in such a way that they now feel as if they are strangers in their own land. And I think that's true for many people. And I think these people are often nostalgic for a world that they've lost, and angry that that world has been lost. For some groups at least, I think there's something correct about this, that there is a world that has been lost. But at some level, these cultural views are remarkably exaggerated. So opinion surveys currently show that something like two-thirds of white American men now say that they feel they are the objects of discrimination. So it's very interesting to think about that. I would say most of us would not think that older white men are the principal objects of discrimination today. And we see some evidence for that in these figures. This comes from some recent research that I'm doing. And these figures report changes in the subjective social status of men and women without a college education. So these are men and women without a college education. In this case, I'm showing you four countries. We've done this for 12 countries. So subjective social status reflects people's feelings about where they stand in the social hierarchy. It's measured in this case, people are said, well, you know, society, there's a kind of social ladder in society. Some people are closer to the towards the top, some people are closer towards the bottom. Where do you think you stand? And people place themselves on the ladder running from 1 to 10. And the results are really quite striking. So in 10 of the 12 countries that for which we have this data, the subjective social status of men without a college education has declined since 1985. In other words, over the past 30 years. These men feel that they no longer have the social standing they once had, although that their counterparts felt 10, 20, or 30 years ago. But I think equally striking here, if you look at the light gray line, the subjective social status of women has increased over the same period. And I think this is really quite remarkable. Some of it undoubtedly results from economic developments, namely the rising rates of female labor force participation. Social status is associated with employment. As more women have moved into work, their sense of social status has increased. And of course, the question that I can't answer, but you can think about if you like, is, well, does the fact that the social status of women is increasing, does that automatically decrease the social status of men? Well, I don't feel that way, but it may be that some men do feel that way, and that may account for some of the results that we see here. Okay, but even though cultural change probably matters, I think it matters, I don't think it's entirely, or maybe even mainly responsible for the rise of populism. And for a fuller account, I think we need to look to a second set of factors, namely recent economic developments. So several scholars have argued in particular that the rise of right-wing populism reflects a revolt against globalization on the part of the losers from globalization, namely those who have seen their jobs disappear or become more insecure, as manufacturing jobs in particular are outsourced to emerging economies. These are American figures for the kinds of occupations in which we've seen the most growth over recent years. And you can see that there's rapid growth, or considerable growth at least, in both low-wage occupations and high-wage occupations. But these middle-wage manufacturing jobs are the jobs that have been disappearing, being outsourced in some sense to emerging economies. And of course, in this context, rising rates of immigration appear as another dimension of globalization, the free movement of people along with the free movement of goods, the free movement of capital. And so I think there's a lot in this notion that right populism in particular is a reflection of a revolt against globalization. In those parts of the United States, those counties that have lost the most manufacturing jobs to Chinese imports, we find, scholars find, increasing support for extremists on both sides, the left of the Democratic Party and the right of the Republican Party. It's a fairly clear-cut association. And there are various good studies that show that support for right populism is associated with personal economic distress. If you think the financial situation of your household has worsened in recent years, you're more likely to vote for right populist parties. But I think we need to be cautious about this notion that the resurgence of populism is a revolt against globalization, because I think this is true, but true only in the broadest and vaguest sense of the term. My reading of the economics is that this movement that we see here in jobs, in employment, is really only tangentially related to more open flows of goods and capital across national borders. A lot of it has to do instead with the development of new technologies, which are gradually eliminating routine jobs and requiring higher levels of skill for those seeking good employment. So for instance, in the face of Chinese competition, and in the face of, if you look at the chart on the right, in the face of Chinese competition, the volume of manufactured goods produced in the United States has not declined. So China has risen, but the U.S. is producing more manufactured goods than it did 30 years ago. In fact, the volume of manufactured goods produced in the U.S. has doubled since 1984. But at the same time, the number of Americans employed in manufacturing jobs has declined by a third. So manufacturing is going up, but it's being done by robots. A well-known American management consultant once said, the factory of the future will have only two employees, a man and a dog. The man will be there to feed the dog, and the dog will be there to keep the man from touching the equipment. I think that's an exaggeration, but it captures something of the flavor of what we're seeing around us. New technology is surely at least as important as Asian competition for eliminating these well-paid jobs in the U.S. And we see something similar in Western Europe, where broad transformations in the economy, and I can't emphasize this enough, I think we're talking about very broad economic transformations, have shifted employment from manufacturing to services. And at the same time, many of those service sector jobs are less well paid, less secure than jobs used to be even a few years ago, if not a few decades ago. And you can see that in this chart, which compares the proportions of employees in part-time and temporary contracts in a range of countries between 1990 and 2015. So in other words, many families are in economic distress, but the causes of that distress probably don't lie mainly in globalization, as I see it, or in European integration, but in a much broader transformation of contemporary economies. And that's a point I'm going to come back to, but before doing that, I want to note a third set of developments that lie behind the contemporary resurgence of populism. And these are broadly political developments. Across, as I think everyone here knows, across the Western democracies, one of the most striking features of populism is a common complaint among its supporters that the mainstream political parties have been paying no attention to them. And we can see that in the decline in trust in national governments, in the EU, which is what you see here. Less than 20% of citizens in the debtor countries of the Eurozone, that is to say Southern Europe in particular, less than a fifth of citizens there even trust their national government. And levels of trust are especially low among people with lower levels, that is to say without a college education. These people are angry. They think no one has been listening to them. and whatever else they might offer, populist candidates promise to speak for them. So there's a Donald Trump at his inaugural address. And this is one reason why so many intellectuals, so many of my friends in Cambridge, Massachusetts, underestimated the political appeal of Donald Trump. They thought his crude remarks about women and all sorts of other things, Muslims and the like, they thought they were offensive. They would turn people off, they'd reduce his support. But those remarks increased his support. In his comments, many ordinary Americans, including some of my neighbors, heard the voice of someone who would stand up to the political establishment, who would finally say something that, while it might have been offensive, was the kind of thing that liberals, middle-class liberals like me, would object to. And they wanted to see someone break the taboos, if you like, of the political establishment. And much the same could be said of Marine Le Pen. This cartoon comes from a French newspaper. I think it really sums it up. Voting can be an expressive act. It can be an emotional act. So this is a, you know, you can't see in the back. If you're in the back, you have trouble seeing the bottom of the slides. Is that right? So these are a group of sheep. They're looking at a poster. The poster is a wolf with a Nazi insignia on his shoulder. And one sheep is saying to the other, "I'm thinking of voting for the wolf. That'll show the shepherd." Well, voting is to some extent like that. It can be an expressive act, an emotional act. People don't always vote for candidates because they have congenial policies. Sometimes they vote for them because they want to express deep-seated emotions of anger or resentment, resentment that no one has been listening to them. And I think, in some sense, the supporters of populist parties are right about that. No one has been listening to them. So, if we look at this slide, which shows you movement in the platforms of the political parties of Western Europe, the OECD countries, from 1940 through 2000, what you notice here is that in the late 1980s and into the 1990s, this only goes up to 2000, the platforms of the parties begin to converge. And in particular, parties of the left move to the right. So parties of the mainstream left and right have converged on a set of policies that are, broadly speaking, neoliberal economic policies. This is a measure of economic policies. Neoliberal, the more neoliberal is up to the top. And of course, this is fine if you benefit from those kinds of policies. But if you don't, this movement has been immensely frustrating. Moreover, the parties have generally portrayed those policies as necessary or inevitable. In other words, they've not paid much attention to the people who lose in the context of neoliberal economic policies. And we can all speculate about why that's been the case, but I think in some measure it's because political elites, intellectual elites, and others have bought into the notion that there's a kind of inexorable process of modernization that at this moment in capitalism, if you like, requires neoliberal economic policies if all are to prosper, and that there really is no alternative, as Margaret Thatcher would have said. And in the face of this, there are going to be losers, but there are bound to be losers, and that's just an inevitable consequence of modernization. And of course, maybe that's true, but if you're one of those losers, you don't want to be seen as an inevitable consequence of modernization. And in some ways, I think that this has produced a politics, a difficult politics, that now has given us this toxic politics of populism. Why now? Well, I think two things happened in particular. First of all, radical right parties in Europe in particular move left on economic issues. Now, radical right parties have been around for quite some time. They've appeared from time to time for throughout the 20th century. But this is a diagram of the classic electoral space. The horizontal axis reflects the standard left-right economic axis. The vertical axis reflects the kind of values axis. People towards the top support cosmopolitan, more universalistic values, people towards the bottom, more traditional, some would say authoritarian values. And this reflects the placement of voters and the placement of parties, let's say in the 1990s into the early 2000s. And you could see that parties of the left in red competed with parties of the right along a kind of diagonal spectrum. And in that period, in the 1990s, this is where parties of the radical right were located. They were essentially around here. So they were appealing to people on traditional values, but their economic positions were, broadly speaking, anti-state, anti-intervention, anti-tax, and the like. Well, what happened in the early 2000s is that these radical right parties moved to the left. So they continued to have a very strong appeal on anti-immigrant issues, on values issues, but now they were also acceptable to many people on economic issues because they began to argue for economic protection, social benefits, provided those benefits didn't go to immigrants and the like. And I think this vastly expanded the electoral appeal of parties like the Front National in France. And of course, you see something very striking in this slide. You see that the left parties and green parties are still on the upper left quadrant. There are a few parties in the lower right quadrant. They're now actually liberal parties in the upper right quadrant. But the only parties in this quadrant are radical right parties, or right populist parties, pretty much. And there are many, many people in that bottom left quadrant. So I think that's the first factor that contributes to the rise of populism, support for right populism in the early 2000s. So the National Front changed its policies, for instance, around 2005 and the like. So at the same time, we see a second development. So because mainstream parties of the left and of the right, the center-left, center-right, had moved so close to one another on economic issues, in order to distinguish themselves, to make a distinctive electoral appeal, they began to put less emphasis on economic policies and more emphasis on identity issues, non-economic issues. And this chart, which tracks the mention of economic issues, the dotted line, versus the mention of non-economic or identity issues in party platforms across 13 Western democracies. You see in the mid-1980s, a politics that had been about economic policy becomes a politics about identity. And a politics about identity plays into the arms of right populism, because there is a politics of friends and enemies. It's a politics which identifies the real people of the nation against the outsiders who are threats to the nation. So political developments, I think, are as important as economic developments to the rise of the populist right. So what conclusions might we draw from this broad overview of the roots of support for the populist right? First, I'm suggesting that those who ask whether the basis of support for populism is primarily economic or primarily cultural are asking the wrong question. This is a phenomenon that is both economic and cultural. We're not going to understand it until we acknowledge that point. And if you think about it, those of you who are political scientists here, think about what we know about the class politics of the 1950s and 60s that was very important in Western Europe. So that was a politics that was built on class divisions, and those divisions had a kind of objective economic reality to them. But people weren't voting for the Labour Party versus the Conservative Party, or the Social Democrats versus the Christian Democrats, just because of their occupation, their role in the economy. They were voting because those economic divisions were married to cultural frameworks that produced a certain kind of identity politics. Class politics was a kind of identity politics. It's disappeared in recent decades. But my point is that we can't see the new populism, we can't see the politics of today as something that is purely economic or purely cultural. It's rooted in economic divisions, but it's built on a new kind of identity politics. Some might say, I think it's a slightly threatening thought, what some might say that populism represents the new class politics of the 21st century. So that's the first conclusion I want to draw. Second, I think we should note, and I've returned to this point I made earlier, that there are important spatial dimensions to populist politics. When we look around us, we see that populism is strongly supported in some regions, strongly opposed in other regions. So that it's not a purely individual phenomenon. So even it has to do with what you think about your community, and it has to do with what you think about the future of your community. So if you live in a locality, you may well have a job, and you may be even moderately happy with that job. But if the community is declining, broadly speaking, in economic terms, if it's in the north of England, or in the northeast of France, or in parts of the Netherlands, as you watch the community decline around you, you feel, in some sense, that your locality is opposed to some national elite, and in particular, your sense of cultural outlook, if you like, is different than the cultural outlook of those who live in large cities. And this was apparent in the case of Brexit, where Scotland and Northern Ireland both supported Remain, while Wales did not. It's apparent in the broader studies. You can see the American figures here on the right, which suggests that opposition to right populism is strongest in the big cities. And this point about big cities and smaller towns is an important one, because these cultural divisions are being reinforced by contemporary patterns of economic development. So in the industrialized democracies, where new technology is becoming the motor for economic growth, big cities are becoming the engines of that growth and the principal sites where people find good, well-paid employment. So as this chart suggests, half of the American national product is produced in 30 large cities. You can see them indicated on the map. The size of the circles indicates the size of the contribution to national product. Half of the American national product is produced in large cities. And we see similar phenomena in the UK, in France, and in many other parts of the world. So there's a way in which this means that if there are growing differences in cultural outlooks between people who live in cities, like Vilnius, and people who live in the countryside or smaller cities, this is becoming a very important political phenomenon. We can see the cultural side of this in Western Europe, certainly. Immigrants are a familiar feature in the large cities of London or Paris or Amsterdam and the like. And while there's some opposition to immigration there, people get used to immigrants. I'm an immigrant into the US. People have got used to me. There's a sense in which the culture, so the patterns of economic development are bifurcated. There's a dualism, a dual economic development. But culture is also becoming, political culture is becoming bifurcated in a similar way. And therefore, I think it's very important to note that populism has an economic and cultural dimension. And finally, populism of both the right and the left, I think, is not simply a reaction to the outsourcing of jobs. It's not simply a reaction to immigration. It's a revolt against economic modernization and the cruelties of that modernization. Born for many people out of a sense that they and their families have lost the secure status they once had in society. Lost or they're losing the communities in which they grew up. And in particular, most important, they're losing the opportunities to which they thought they could once aspire. And I think this collective sense of loss of opportunity is very important here. We see this in the exit polls for the Brexit referendum. I don't know if you could read that in the back, but what these essentially say is that two of the questions that most distinguish the supporters of Brexit, the supporters of leaving the EU, from those who want to remain in the EU, are questions that ask people whether life is going to be better for your children than it was for you, and whether life is better today than it was 30 years ago. I don't have a pointer here, but the second question down is, for most children growing up in Britain today, life will be better than it was for their parents. Those who supported Remain agreed with that, but by a margin of 22%, those who supported Brexit thought that life would be worse for their children than it was for them. And can we imagine any more potent attitude for its political significance than thinking, is life going to be better for your children, or is it going to be worse for your children? And I think it's very hard to capture this empirically, but I think this is an important part of populism. And this matters because if populism is built on a sense of loss, a sense of loss of opportunity, we know from psychologists and historians that this makes it a very powerful political phenomenon. Psychologists tell us that people are much more likely to fight for something that they fear losing than they are to fight for something that they might gain. And if we look at another period of profound economic transformation, we look at Britain, for instance, in the early 1800s, the Industrial Revolution, Lunas and I were talking about that by chance earlier today. Well, look at the worker protests in that period, and read the historians, what the British workers in the face of the new factory system were protesting about, what brought them out into the streets and led them to smash the machines, was not some kind of reformist vision of what the world could be like for them. It was a sense, in that famous phrase, of the world that they had lost, this agrarian world in which their families had been more together, and in a sense, they had jobs, a world that they understood. So if populism is animated by a sense that people are losing something they once had, then it's a political phenomenon that is not going to pass in 2 years or 5 years or 10 years. I think it's a phenomenon that will be around for some time. All right. I think my time is running short, so let me close by saying a few words about the implications of populism for contemporary democracy, and I'll be brief about this, and I'm sure some of you will have views to express about this as well. Is the resurgence of populism a threat to contemporary democracy? This is a very large subject. It's an open question in some sense. Well, I think the first thing that has to be said is that populism is to some extent a reflection of democracy. If these are people who feel that no one has been speaking for them, that their voice has not been heard, then there are some ways in which the populist movements have to be seen as a natural democratic phenomenon and something that we can't entirely condemn. Populist candidates give people a voice that they might not have had before. But I think right-wing populism in particular poses a genuine threat to democracy, and I think so for three reasons. I'll close on this. First, as I said a minute ago, the politics of populism is a politics of friends and enemies. It feeds on a divisive nationalism that undermines the social solidarity and tolerance for the views and lifestyles of others that is a critical bulwark for democracy. If we can't tolerate the views and the living situation of other people, then it's very difficult to live together. It's very difficult to accept the decisions of a democratic government. Secondly, I think that the scorn for experts that populists express, and there's a sense in which that's at the heart of populism. In some ways, it's populism against technocracy. And there's a way in which those are two poles of politics, if you like. Well, so there's something to be said against technocracy, but the scorn that populists express for experts, their willingness to say almost anything, regardless of how true it is, in order to inflame their supporters, sucks the last vestiges of credibility out of democratic political discourse, like a vacuum sucking air out of a ball. And I think that although populists are not the only politicians who sometimes say things that aren't entirely true, they're a central factor in the development of what some people are calling post-truth politics. And if we have a post-truth politics in which we don't know who to trust, we don't know what in the media to believe or not believe, then it's very hard to operate an effective democracy. And then finally, of course, as you know better than I, in countries such as Hungary and Poland and Turkey, we're seeing populist leaders erode the independence of the judiciary, undermine the systems of checks and balances that are absolutely crucial to the operation of liberal democracy. I think those checks and balances may be reasonably safe in long-established democracies. Some of my friends are worried. I'm not terribly worried about the U.S. in that sense. But these developments certainly threaten democracy in countries where it's a more recent and maybe tenuous phenomenon. So I think I better stop there. I hope I've said enough about my views to stimulate some discussion and maybe some discourse.